After waiting several hours, the time has come.
Good afternoon, everyone. This is 2 of 8, 7. And to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, I hope you're having a happy and a blessed Sabbath. Now, I want to do this video today, once again, catered to you ladies out there, you mothers, wives, sisters, daughters, what have you, those of you who have households. So many of you are having issues and chaos run amok in your household that we've been getting a lot of questions and so forth, asking us to help, you know, with whatever guidance or edifying that you require. Now, with this one, there's going to be a twist, so to speak. This one's for you all, but it's about the men, the husbands, the fathers out there, because it makes no sense for you to strive to work so hard on fixing what's right with you spiritually, and your husband or the fathers out here are just as lost as they can be and have no guidance. And this is really, like all the videos I do, they're only going to apply to people who are trying to do spiritually right, because there's going to be no success in anything we do if we aren't spiritually right and grounded. And we have to be there and continually strive, because we're continually going to be tested, and we're going to go through things, we're going to go through trials, we're going to go through tribulations, we're going to go through hurt, pain, sorrow, all these things. The Father tells us we're going to go through some stuff, but we have to be tried in the fire. We have to prove our worth to enter into the new kingdom. So this one today is catered toward the men. And with that, we're going to start with Romans 7. So go with me to Romans 7. Verse 2 and 3. Now Romans 7 reads, it says, "For the woman which hath an husband is bound by the law to her husband so as long as he liveth. But if the husband be dead, she is loosed from the law of her husband." Verse 3. "So then, if while her husband liveth, she be married to another man, she shall be called an adulteress. But if her husband be dead, she is free from the law, so that she is no adulteress, though she be married to another man." And this applies both ways. If you are married and your spouse or former spouse is still alive, if you're married, you're bound by the law of marriage. But if you're married to another person and that person you were married to is still alive, you are considered an adulteress. This is coming from the Word. Forget all what the world says. The Word says you're an adulteress. Now, let me say this. A lot of us have gotten into marriages and out of marriages and back into marriages, and none of them have been spiritually grounded. Yeah, a lot of us go get counseling from pastors and preachers and whomever, premarital counseling they call it, but were you living your life spiritually in the first place? I mean, living by the Word in the first place. And if not, it's really all really a moot point, because we're entering into unscriptural marriages if we aren't living it. So it stands to reason that we don't understand what we're getting into as we get into it. And then the next thing you know, because we're tired of our spouse, their attitude, their mismanaging of money, cheating, whatever the case may be. We're going to talk about cheating. But whatever it is, we just get tired and don't want to be married anymore, them or us, and then we get out of these marriages. We're doing all these things unscripturally because we got into unscriptural marriages. It's not uncommon that people get married and then someone finds themselves spiritually and then understand what they've gotten themselves into and try to live it accordingly. And then when the other spouse starts doing wrong and they want to leave or want a divorce, now you're stuck in a quagmire because you understand the principles of marriage, that we're supposed to be in these for life, and now you don't want to violate scripture by getting a divorce. But still, the bottom line is, you got into an unscriptural marriage. So it's going to be a tough battle. Now, in terms of cheating, adultery, we all know that scripture says that that is the only cause for divorce, unless the other spouse is dead. Okay, go with me to Matthew 19, and we're going to start with verse 3. It's an interesting scripture here, because as always, people will try and trip you up with what the law says and try and make your position on it be a contradiction. And it's no different than Pharisees were constantly trying to do this with the Savior. Matthew 19, starting with verse 3, reads, it says, "The Pharisees also came unto him, tempting him, and saying unto him, Is it lawful for a man to put away his wife for every cause?" So the question they were asking him, is it lawful or is it okay for a man to divorce his wife for any cause? Now, they already knew that the law says that the only cause for divorce is adultery. But they're trying to trip the Savior up by asking him this question, as people do that with us nowadays. Now, he answers them in verse 4 and says, "Have you not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female, and said, For this cause shall a man leave father and mother, and shall cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh." So the two of them will leave their parents and come together and become one. Verse 6, "Wherefore there is no more twain, but one flesh." See, it's no longer two, they're one. "What therefore God have joined together, let no man put asunder." And then in verse 7 it reads, "They say unto him, Why did Moses then command to give a writing of divorcement and put her away?" Now, I've been approached with this question, because people will say, "Well, why did it say in Moses that if you're going to divorce your wife, write a decree of divorcement?" The Savior answers this. See, people are always trying to trip up the law to make it void by saying that it's a fraud. But this is what he said to him in verse 8. "Moses, because of the hardness of your hearts, suffered you to put away your wives. But from the beginning it was not so." Verse 9. And I say unto you, whosoever shall put away his wife, except it be for fornication, and shall marry another, committeth adultery. And whoso marrieth her which is put away, doeth commit adultery." So, what we're told is that because of the hardness in our hearts, see, people today will divorce for any reason. And that's because of the hardness in their heart. They don't want to keep the commandment or the laws of Scripture. They want a single life. They're tired of being married. Whatever the reason. And that's hardness in our heart. We don't want to do what's right. We don't want to work in the marriage. So the Savior said, this is your hardness. But if you're going to do it, write a decree saying that you divorce this individual. See, he's not saying it's right. He's saying if you're going to do it, write the decree of divorcement so that it's on paper, that it's written, so everyone knows what's going on. So don't try and twist what the word says. With all that being said, understand, this is why you should enter a marriage fully realizing that it is a lifetime commitment. Now, and women, understand this. Men, to a degree, understand that if they get married, it's supposed to be for a lifetime commitment. This is why so many men have commitment issues, because they understand lifetime. And it frightens them, because they're not sure they want to commit for a lifetime. And a lot of them do it anyway for financial reasons, for sexual reasons. And more often than not, a lot of men will marry you because you put pressure on them. Did you hear me? You put pressure on them because you don't want to do all these things and not be married, because you've been raised and conditioned in this fantasy of marriage, and you want these things. And a lot of you get into these marriages under the wrong pretenses also. It's not just the men. So you have this idea and love in your mind about these beautiful weddings and marriage and all this. So you're raised to put pressure on guys because you understand that all this sexual activity and living together and all these things are just morally wrong in the first place. So you put pressure on the guy, you ask him, and the pressure's already on him because he already knows it's coming before you even ask. Men understand this. So men will put you off. They'll engage you with an engagement ring. That'll put you off. They'll put you off with promise rings. Their excuses of, well, we're not financially ready, so when we get financially ready, when we finish school, when we get set in our careers, when we do this, when we do that, and then the next thing you know, here you are in these relationships 4, 5, 6, 8, 10 years later with children, houses, cars, everything in each other's names, and what have you, and yet you still are sweating the issue of getting married. You've done everything but get married. And now he has no reason to be pressured or accept the pressure that you put on him anymore because he has the whole kit and caboodle. So men understand this. Don't get it twisted. Men know the game. Men don't want to commit because, see, for men, in a lot of men's mind, as long as they're not married to you, there is a possibility of an out clause. There is a possibility of an out clause. Men will ride that forever, knowing that they have a card, a whole card. And it's irrational when you think about it, when men do so many things to engage everything except signing that piece of paper, but set up the whole household and do everything but marry you anyway. So understand this, men get it. Men know. Ladies, you have to, like I said in my previous videos, you have to marry the right man in the first place. You can't marry the wrong man or the man that's not ready and then expect somewhere down the line he's going to be ready. You can't engage yourself in a relationship with a man for an extended period of time in the hope that he's going to get ready and ask you to marry him. You have to have standards, you have to stand by them. You have to be right in the first place. Remember this, to marry the right person, you have to be the right person. So you be right first, and then you'll know what you should expect of him. You'll be able to recognize the other right person. So, men, when you get into these marriages, do it with the full understanding that it is a lifetime commitment and live it accordingly. Be ready to work at your marriage, and women, be ready to work with them in these marriages. But they're not going to work forever unless they are spiritually grounded. So even if you got into a marriage that's unspiritually grounded in the first place, work on getting it spiritually grounded and go from there, so you both understand how to manage your marriage and make it a happy marriage. So with that, I'll be back with my next one, which will be explaining to the husbands that they should love their wife and how they should go about that. And with that being said, remember, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is 2Bait7. I'm out.